Can we trust the New Testament? This question could mean a number of different things. It could mean, is the New Testament historically accurate? It might mean, is it theologically true? It might mean, is it internally consistent? Those are all important questions, but they are not our focus tonight. Instead, our focus is on a more specific question: can we trust the text of the New Testament? And by text, we mean quite literally the words that make up the New Testament. Can we know the original text? Can we know the exact words the original authors wrote? Or has the text become so garbled by the mistakes and intentional changes by scribes over the centuries that we can no longer know what the texts originally were? Another way of thinking about this question is to ask this: how badly did ancient and medieval scribes corrupt the text of the New Testament? This is a crucial question for properly understanding the New Testament. And as our speakers will note, we do not have any of the original manuscripts that the biblical writers produced. We don't have a single original, not a single autograph. I refer you to the glossary in your program for definitions of technical terms like autograph. Instead of autographs, what we have are copies, or rather, copies of copies, or even copies of copies of copies. On the one hand, we're fortunate to have thousands of these copies, over 5,800 Greek manuscripts of various sizes, with more still being discovered. For example, a team from the center led by Dr. Wallace just this past spring discovered 4 new Greek biblical manuscripts in Athens. In addition to Greek manuscripts, we also have thousands more manuscripts in languages like Latin, Coptic, Ethiopic, Slavic, Georgian, Armenian, Syriac. We also have quotes and allusions to the New Testament from various ancient writers. So this is a remarkable set of data. Think of the skill set that scholars have to work to actually read all of these languages. This is why text criticism is one of the most difficult subfields of biblical studies in which to work. This abundance of data, however, creates its own set of problems. We have all of these manuscripts, but they differ from each other because of the text variants introduced by scribes. When we compare the different readings, can we determine that one reading is more likely to be original than the others? If not, if we can't construct the original text, how far back can we push it? How early can we get? And if we can't determine the original text, how much does it matter? These are the sorts of questions that text critics tackle. And we're fortunate to have two of the best known text critics in the world, Daniel B. Wallace and Bart D. Ehrman. We'll see that when they examine the evidence, they find much with which to agree with each other, but they find much on which they disagree. Ehrman has argued that we can't always know the original text of the biblical writers, while Wallace's center is devoted to the great and noble task of determining the autographs of the New Testament. That's a quote from the center's website. For Ehrman, we will always have significant gaps in our knowledge of the original text unless an autograph turns up. For Wallace, while the task of determining the original is not complete, it can be done, and we are well on our way to doing it. Clearly, they disagree. And yet, as you'll see, despite their differences, they obviously have great professional respect for each other. Our format for tonight is laid out in the program. Each scholar will present an opening argument of approximately 30 minutes. First, Dr. Ehrman, then Dr. Wallace. After the opening arguments, the two will have opportunities to respond to each other, and then another round of response after that. Afterwards, there will be time for questions from the audience, and we'll conclude with closing arguments, first by Dr. Ehrman and then by Dr. Wallace. You will then go home and debate who won. I'll introduce each speaker before his opening argument, and now I'll begin. Bart D. Ehrman is the James A. Gray Distinguished Teacher in the Department of Religious Studies at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. He earned his BA from Wheaton College, his Master of Divinity, and PhD from Princeton Theological Seminary, where he worked with famed text critic Bruce Metzger. After teaching for a few years at Rutgers University, he arrived at the University of North Carolina in 1988. Ehrman has lectured all over the world, but you don't have to leave home to listen to him. He's videotaped several lecture series through the Teaching Company. You may have encountered him on his numerous radio and television appearances on CNN and on shows like Fresh Air with Terry Gross, The Diane Rehm Show, The Daily Show with Jon Stewart, and even The Colbert Report twice. Unfortunately, New Testament scholars by definition are unable to reach any level of cool. So, nice try. Ehrman has authored, co-authored, or edited 26 books. That was yesterday's count. It may be outdated. Many of these have been enormously successful. At least four have made it onto the New York Times bestseller list, which never happens for biblical scholarship. In turning biblical scholarship into bestsellers, Dr. Ehrman has inadvertently proven that miracles do happen. His books range from technical studies of inscriptions and particular text-critical problems to widely used introductory textbooks such as the New Testament and Historical Introduction to Early Christian Writings, which just entered its fifth edition, to works on the historical Jesus, the Lost Gospel of Judas, and Peter, Paul, and Mary, Magdalene. His most recent book, just out, is Forged, Writing in the Name of God, Why the Bible's Authors Are Not Who We Think They Are. For our purposes, I would like to highlight three other books. He's the co-author with the late Bruce Metzger of the fifth edition of the classic book, The Text of the New Testament, which is a standard reference for students and scholars alike. He also wrote The Orthodox Corruption of Scripture, The Effect of Early Christological Controversies on the Text of the New Testament, in which he argued that some of the changes scribes made to the biblical text were theologically motivated. He continues this same argument in the more popular level book, Misquoting Jesus, The Story Behind Who Changed the Bible and Why, which is a very readable introduction to text criticism for those just beginning to learn about it. In short, he has thought quite a bit and written quite a lot on the issues under discussion tonight. Bart, we welcome you here tonight, and we ask, can we trust the text of the New Testament?
Well, thank you very much for that generous introduction, Mark, and thank you all for coming out. Just to get things started, let me ask, how many of you would consider yourselves Bible-believing Christians? Right, okay. How many of you are here to see me get creamed? Right. Okay. All right, so all I ask is that you approach it with an open mind. I have long thought about these issues, as Mark was pointing out. I did my PhD with Bruce Metzger, who was the world's leading scholar in text criticism. I was his final PhD student. I did both a master's thesis and a PhD dissertation under him. And then when I graduated from Princeton Seminary, I wrote for several years nothing except four books on textual criticism. I decided a number of years ago, 5 or 6 years ago, to try and write a book for popular audiences to explain what it is scholars have said about this field, and that was the book Misquoting Jesus that Mark mentioned. I should say that when I wrote Misquoting Jesus, that's not the title that I wanted to give it. You may not know this, but scholars who write books for popular audiences usually don't give the titles to the book. They're not allowed to give the titles to the book, and it's not a title that that I wanted. Since the book has to deals with how the New Testament had been transmitted over the centuries by scribes who sometimes changed the text, my preferred title for the book was Lost in Transmission, which I thought was a pretty good title. My publisher, though, decided against it because they thought that in places like Texas, if we called it Lost in Transmission and somebody went to the Barnes & Noble and saw it on the shelf, they would assume that it was a book about NASCAR. I suggested that might improve sales. Can we trust the text of the New Testament? To get to this question, I need to give a little bit of background about how we got the New Testaments. When you read the New Testament today, you pick up the Gospel of Mark and you read the words and you assume you're reading the words that Mark wrote. Of course you assume that. But you're reading them in English and Mark wrote in Greek. And are you reading the words that Mark himself actually wrote, even if they are correctly translated from Greek into English? First, we have to think about the original Mark. We don't know who Mark was, we don't know where he lived, we don't know when he was writing. It's usually thought that he was a Greek-speaking Christian living, writing sometime around the year 70, so about 40 years after Jesus' death. And some people think he was writing in Rome. I don't know where he was writing. Let's say he was writing in Rome. Let's say he's writing in Rome around the year 70. Mark wrote down an account of Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. This book that he wrote was put into circulation the way books were typically put in circulation in the ancient world. It got handed around. If somebody wanted a copy of the book, they couldn't simply go to the Barnes & Noble. There wasn't a Barnes & Noble, and the book had not been mass-produced. It had been written either by Mark himself or by a scribe by hand. If somebody wanted to have a copy of their own, they had to make a copy, or to have somebody else make a copy for them. And so Mark was eventually copied. Maybe Mark was copied many times. Maybe he was copied only a couple of times. But once it was copied, more copies were needed, and so some people copied the copies. And then some people copied the copies of the copies. And some people copied the copies of the copies of the copies of the copies. Now, I don't know if you've ever tried to write out a copy of one of the books of the New Testament, like the Gospel of Mark, but I can guarantee you, if you do that, you're going to make a mistake. You might make lots of mistakes, and you are much more highly educated and literate than the vast majority of early Christians. Mistakes happen when people copy texts. And the problem is, when somebody copies a text and makes a mistake, the next person who copies the copy replicates the mistakes of his predecessor. And he makes mistakes of his own. And then somebody comes along and copies that copy. And when they copy that copy, they replicate the mistakes of both of their predecessors, and they make their own mistakes. And then somebody copies that copy. And it goes on like that for year after year after year. The only time mistakes get corrected is when a scribe is copying a text and they realize, oh, this copy has a mistake. And they try to correct the mistake. But they don't know what the original said. They're just trying to make it right. It's possible that when somebody tries to correct a mistake, that they correct it incorrectly. In which case, you've got the original copy, you've got the mistake, and you've got the mistake and correction of the mistake. Three forms of the text, and then somebody copies that form of the text. And it goes on like that. Month after month, year after year, decade after decade. And so you get copies of the copies of the copies. We don't have the original version of Mark. We don't have the book he wrote. We don't have the first copy made of Mark, or any of the first copies, or copies of the copies, and we don't have copies of the copies of the copies of Mark. Mark's book was copied for very many years before we have any copy. The first copy we have of Mark is a manuscript that scholars have called P45. Now, they call it P45 because it's written on papyrus, which was the ancient equivalent of paper. It was the writing material people used to use, and it's called P45 because this happens to be the 45th papyrus manuscript of the New Testament that was cataloged. And so it's called P45. This is what it looks like. This is one page of P45. You can see that it is not a complete page. As you can see, there are holes in the manuscript here, and some of the margin is missing here. But this is actually one of the best preserved pages of this manuscript, P45. P45 is not a complete manuscript of Mark. Obviously, there's some things missing on this particular page. It doesn't have anything from the first three chapters. It starts with chapter 4, this surviving fragment we have. It's not entire. It's just fragmentary. This copy has only 5 verses from Mark chapter 4, and then it has verses from the following several 8 chapters. It goes from basically chapter 4 to chapter 12, so it doesn't have the last 4 chapters. It doesn't have the first 3 chapters, so it's missing the first 3, the last 4, and it has some bits of the stuff in between. This is our first copy of the Gospel of Mark that survived, except for small fragments. We have a small scrap or two here or there, but this is basically the first copy of any use to us. So it's our oldest copy, and it's usually dated to around the year 220 CE or AD 220. Now, if Mark was written in the year 70, that means this copy was made 150 years after the original, and it's our first copy. This kind of time gap is not unusual in the New Testament. This is the kind of time gap we're talking about for most of the books of the New Testament, not just the Gospel of Mark, for most of them. I'm just using Mark as an illustration. We don't have a complete copy of the Gospel of Mark until the middle of the 4th century. Until about the middle of the 4th century, 300 years of copying before we have a complete copy that survives. There were lots of copies made before this complete copy, and there were lots of copies made before P45. P45 is not a copy of the original Mark. It's a copy probably of a copy made a few years earlier, which was a copy of a copy made a few years earlier, which was a copy of a copy made a few years earlier, and so on and so on. There have been numerable stages between the original and our first copy. How many mistakes had crept into the text before we start getting copies? There's no way to know, because we don't have earlier copies. These are the earliest. The first complete copy, 300 years after. How many intervening stages of copying was it? We simply don't know. We can't know because we don't have the manuscripts to tell us. This, again, is not simply true for the Gospel of Mark. It's true for all of the books of the New Testament. It seems like when you buy the New Testament that we know what's in it, because you go to the bookstore and you buy a New Testament, and, you know, you go to another bookstore, you buy the New Testament. It's the same thing, but not in the ancient world. If you lived in Rome and you read a copy of Mark, and then you went to Ephesus and read a copy of Mark, you might be reading two different copies with two different wordings of this passage or that passage. These copies are circulating throughout the Roman world. Wherever Christians were, they wanted copies of the Gospels. If you wanted a copy of the Gospel and you lived in Ephesus, but it was made in Rome, you had to make a copy in Rome and take it to Ephesus. And then you made a copy that was maybe a copy of the copy of the copy. So maybe you're making a copy of a copy that in fact had a lot of mistakes in it, but that's the copy you have now in Ephesus. And suppose somebody from Colossae wants a copy. So they come to Ephesus and they make a copy of this mistaken copy, and that's the Gospel they have in Colossae. And then suppose somebody from Antioch wants a copy. Well, they come to Colossae and they make a copy there of this errant copy that's based on copies of the copies of the copies, and it circulates around the Roman world like this, with everybody making mistakes and no way for us to know what mistakes had been made at the early stages. That's the problem we're confronted with the text of the New Testament. So, what can we say about our surviving copies? Well, the good news is we have lots of copies of the New Testament. We have lots more copies of the New Testament than for any other book in the ancient world. We have so many more copies than we have of Plato, or of Euripides, or of Homer, or of Aeschylus. Name your author. We have far more copies of the New Testament than any. So that's the good news. The bad news is we don't have any of the early copies. It's nice that we have copies from later centuries, but we don't have the copies that we want, which are the copies from the early centuries. What can we say about the ages of these copies? Well, the oldest copy of Mark is P45, which we looked at from the year 220. We have a fragment of a piece of the New Testament from almost 100 years earlier, maybe 100 years. It's hard to date these things. The way they date manuscripts is on the basis of handwriting analysis, basically. I mean, to simplify things, it's on the basis of handwriting analysis. There are scholars who are called paleographers who are able to look at a Greek manuscript and on the basis of the style of the handwriting, tell you when it was written within about 50 years. Well, so we have this scrap called P52, the 52nd papyrus catalog, which is a tiny scrap, probably from the early 2nd century, so maybe 180 years or 100 years before P45. It's a little credit card-sized fragment. It's about the size of a credit card, written on both front and back, that contains some parts of some verses from John chapter 18. The trial of Jesus before Pilate. It doesn't contain any complete verses. It is a triangular-shaped fragment that was discovered in the basement of the John Rylands Library in England, where the scholars realized what it was. It was discovered someplace in Egypt, as all these papyri were. So it gives us a few verses, which is great. I mean, it's great to know that you had a copy of John floating around in the early 2nd century, but it's just a few lines. It isn't very much. The vast majority of our manuscripts that survive are from after the 9th century. So if these books, if all the books of the New Testament are written in the 1st century, as almost everybody thinks, then we don't really start getting lots of copies until the 9th century. These 9th century manuscripts we have are abundant. We have thousands of manuscripts from the 9th century, the 10th century, 11th century, 12th century, and so forth. But that's not the problem. It's nice that we have these later manuscripts, but they're based on earlier manuscripts, which were based on earlier manuscripts, which were based on earlier manuscripts, and we don't know how good those manuscripts were. That's the problem. As a result of the copying practices, there are lots of mistakes found in our surviving copies. Lots of mistakes. In the year 1707, so long time ago, in the year 1707, there was a scholar at Oxford whose name was John Mill, who decided to publish an edition of the Greek New Testament, in which he had studied some Greek manuscripts that were available to him of the Greek New Testament. He studied 100 manuscripts. And he made a note of wherever these manuscripts had differences, where they disagreed with one another and how to word a sentence. He didn't note all the differences, just the ones that he thought were important. And so he made a note of all the what he thought were the important differences in the manuscripts, and he then produced an edition of the Greek New Testament. At the top of the page, he wrote out a line or two or three or five of the Greek New Testament, and at the bottom of the page, he listed the places where he had found different readings, what we call variant readings. And so he did this page after page for the entire New Testament, where among the 100 manuscripts he examined, he had found differences. To the shock and dismay of many of his readers, John Mill's Greek New Testament contained 30,000 places of variation among the manuscripts that he had examined. 30,000 places where the manuscripts differed from one another. This really upset some people. There were people who claimed that John Mill was trying to render the text of the New Testament uncertain. His supporters pointed out he didn't invent these 30,000 places. He just noted that they exist. Well, that was 300 years ago, and it was based on a study of 100 manuscripts. Now we have 5,600 manuscripts. How many differences do we know about today? The reality is, nobody knows. Nobody has been able to count all the differences in our manuscripts. Some scholars say there are 200,000 differences. Some say there are 300,000 differences. Some say there are 400,000 differences. We don't know. Even with the advances of computer technology, we don't know. One thing we can say for certain is that there are more differences in our manuscripts than there are words in the New Testament. There are a lot of differences in the manuscripts. And those are just the manuscripts we have. How many differences were there earlier? We don't know. Now, what kind of mistakes do we have in these manuscripts? So, just to be quite clear about this, most of these 300,000, 400,000 differences are completely immaterial, insignificant, and don't matter for a thing other than to show that scribes in the ancient world could spell no better than my students can today. And, you know, they didn't have dictionaries. They certainly didn't have spell check. I mean, these students today, I mean, how can you possibly misspell a word? The computer puts a red line under it. I mean, how dumb do you have to be to misspell a word? Well, scribes didn't have that. And so, you know, the majority of differences, I mean, if you just count them up, are probably misspelling words. These are what I would call an accidental kind of change. Scribes just couldn't spell. And you know the scribes actually didn't care how they spelled, because sometimes you'll have the same word, like two lines later, spelled differently. They didn't, you know, it wasn't an issue for them. Well, those are differences. And so, well, who cares about spelling differences? Well, you know, most of us don't care that much. There actually are some spelling differences that matter, but most spelling differences don't matter for anything. There are other kinds of accidental mistakes that you find in manuscripts. I mean, scribes often were incompetent, or they were sleepy, or they were inattentive, and so they made mistakes. Scribes sometimes would leave out a letter. Sometimes they'd leave out a word. They would often leave out an entire line. Their eye would skip from one line to the next line, and so they would leave out a line. There are some manuscripts where scribes have left out a page. Well, that's an inattentive scribe. There are other places where scribes accidentally copy the same word twice, or the same line twice. I don't know of any instances of copying the same page twice. So these are what I would call accidental changes. They are by far the majority of the variations that we have in our manuscripts. And the thing is, these accidental mistakes are usually pretty easy. If you're trained, they're pretty easy to catch, and you can see where it's happened. And so they're not all that significant for trying to know what the authors said. But I do have to say this about the accidental changes. There probably were even more accidental changes in the years before we have surviving manuscripts. Now, my reason for thinking that is this. By the time you get to, say, the Middle Ages, who is copying manuscripts? The people copying manuscripts in the Middle Ages are the highly educated, literate people who are monks in monasteries who are trained to copy manuscripts. Those are the people who copied manuscripts in the Middle Ages. Well, you didn't have monks in the 4th century, so when we first start getting complete manuscripts, who was copying them then if you don't have monks in monasteries yet? Well, then the people copying them in the 4th century, at least the 4th century manuscripts we have, are pretty good. So they're written by highly literate people who appear to be trained to copy manuscripts in the 4th century. But things start changing when you start getting earlier. The manuscripts in the 3rd century aren't nearly as good as the manuscripts in the 4th century. The scribes don't appear to be trained. When you get to the 2nd century, many of the manuscripts, we don't have much, we just have fragments here and there from the 2nd century, but they're not nearly as good as those 4th century manuscripts. Who was copying the manuscripts to begin with? The reality is that most people in the ancient world were illiterate. This seems strange to us today because almost everybody we know is basically literate. I mean, literacy is still a big problem in this country, but 99% of the population in the United States can at least read the sports page. In the ancient world, maybe 10% of the population could read the sports page.
they didn't have sports pages, but they could, in theory, have read the sports page. Most people couldn't read. Most people couldn't write. Who copied the manuscripts? In the early Christian churches, probably whoever the guy was in the church who at least could read something was the person who copied the manuscript. Was he trained as a scribe? No. Well, then, how good was he? Probably not very good. He probably made accidental mistakes that got replicated and replicated and replicated into our surviving manuscript. Probably. I mean, I don't know. Nobody knows. Dan doesn't know. Now, he's going to tell you he knows, but I'm telling you he doesn't know. In addition to the accidental mistakes, there are intentional mistakes, which are by far the most interesting kinds of mistakes, and I'm going to give you several examples of ones that strike me as rather significant. Changes where a scribe will, it looks like he's intentionally changing something. Now, we don't have the scribes around to interview, so we don't know that they intentionally changed. I mean, we can't ask them, did you do this on purpose or not? But you're going to see from these examples, it looks like somebody's doing this on purpose, probably. If not, it's just a massive accident. But they still are important changes. And so we'll look at those. Before, I just want to make one final point, that the earliest scribes were much worse than the later scribes. They certainly made a lot more accidental changes. They may have made a lot more intentional changes, and there's no way for us to know. Let me tell you about some of the intentional changes. I'll just give you a list of ones. That these will be passages that if you know your Bibles well, which I have a strange feeling you do, unlike my students at Chapel Hill, these will be passages that you probably know about. In the King James Bible, 1 John chapter 5, verses 7 and 8, provides us with the only place in the entire New Testament where the doctrine of the Trinity is explicitly taught. The doctrine of the Trinity is that there are three persons in the Godhead, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and those are not three gods, the three are one. 1 John chapter 5, verses 7 and 8, in the King James Bible, refers to there are three in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Spirit, and these three are one. That's in the King James Bible, but it's not in the Greek manuscript. You get it, it's actually in a few Greek manuscripts, and it's in Latin manuscripts, which was at the heart of the Latin Vulgate. It's an important verse because, as I said, you can intuit or you can reason towards the Trinity from other passages in the New Testament. This is the only passage that explicitly teaches it, and it wasn't originally in the New Testament. Dan and I do not disagree on this point. This verse was not originally in the New Testament. Is it an important verse? Well, it was for my grandfather. When the Revised Standard Version came out in 1952, he went through the roof. Because it didn't have the teaching of the Trinity. They took out the Trinity. This was a huge offense. Not nearly as offensive as I would be to him, but it was a huge offense. Well, it's a rather important matter whether this verse is in there or not. Is Jesus ever called the unique God in the New Testament? It depends which manuscript you trust for John chapter 1, verse 18. Some of our manuscripts, the manuscripts that some textual scholars prefer and others don't prefer, some in this verse talk about Jesus as the unique God. No one has seen the Father at any time. The unique Son or the unique God who is in the bosom of the Father, that one has made him known. Is Jesus actually the unique God himself? Or is he the Son of God? Both are important, but I mean, it does matter whether Jesus is called God, the God, in the New Testament. Depends what you do with John chapter 1, verse 18. Does the Gospel of Luke teach a doctrine of atonement? The doctrine of atonement is that Christ's death is the death for sins. Luke, interestingly, changes a number of verses that he found in his predecessor, the Gospel of Mark, which talked about Jesus as an atonement for sins. Okay, so this is a little bit complicated, but everybody, most Bible scholars, I think most Bible scholars agree that Mark was the first gospel written and that Luke copied Mark for some of his stories, and he got stories from other sources. One of the verses in Mark is a very famous verse from Mark chapter 10. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. This is a verse that Luke excluded when he gave his account of Jesus' life. He doesn't include that verse for whatever reason. It is striking that the only place where Luke's ideas about Jesus' death indicate that his death was an atonement for sins is in the passage Luke 22, verses 19 and 20, where Jesus is at the Last Supper. Jesus, in Luke's gospel, Jesus first gives the cup before he gives the bread. This is the cup of the new covenant, etc. Then he gives the bread. This is my body broken. And then, in some manuscripts, it doesn't just say, this is my body that's been broken. It says, this is my body that has been broken for you. And then it goes on to say, this cup is the covenant of my blood, which is shed for you. The death of Jesus for the sake of others, which is otherwise missing in Luke. And you say, well, so what if it's missing in Luke? It's in Matthew. Okay, but does it matter what Luke says or not? You say, no, it doesn't matter. It just matters what Matthew says. Really? Luke doesn't have a doctrine of atonement depending on which manuscript you trust for chapter 22. The favorite story of many Bible readers of Jesus is the story of Jesus and the woman taken in adultery. Jesus is teaching in the temple. Y'all know the story. It's in all the Jesus movies. This story is so good, you can't leave it out of a Jesus movie. When Mel Gibson made The Passion of the Christ, even though it was about Jesus' last hours, he had to include this story, so he included it as a flashback. Right? Jesus was remembering this happened because you can't make a Jesus movie without the woman taken in adultery. Let the one without sin among you be the first to cast a stone at her. It's found in manuscripts of the Gospel of John, but it's not originally in the Gospel of John, probably, because it's not in the earliest manuscripts of John. It's a story that was added later after our earliest manuscripts. How many stories were added before our earliest manuscripts? We have no way of knowing. They may have been some of our favorite stories. How would we know? We can't know. We don't have any evidence. The last 12 verses of Mark, where Jesus appears to his disciples and tells them that anyone that, who converts and believes in him will be able to speak in foreign tongues, will be able to handle deadly snakes, will drink poison and it won't hurt them, those verses are not found in the oldest and best manuscripts of Mark. These are the verses used by the Appalachian snake handlers in my part of the world. I've always thought that on the way to the hospital, somebody should tell one of these people, actually, you know, those verses aren't in the original copy of the Gospel. Did Jesus pray, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing? It's found only in Luke, but it may not be in Luke because some manuscripts lack it. You can see these are pretty important verses. So even though most of the changes are accidental, some of the intentional ones really matter. Is the text of the New Testament reliable? The short answer is there is no way to tell. How can we possibly know, given the kinds of evidence we have? There are passages that scholars continue to debate. Scholars disagree on this verse or that verse, sometimes important verses. They debate because we can't know. There are passages where we will never know what the original wording was. Does it matter? In my view, the answer is absolutely yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ehrman. Our second speaker is Dr. Daniel B. Wallace. As I noted earlier, Dr. Wallace is a professor of New Testament studies at Dallas Theological Seminary and the founder and executive director of the Center for the Study of New Testament Manuscripts. He earned a BA at Biola University and a THM and PhD at Dallas Theological Seminary. An ordained Baptist minister who has held several ministry positions, he has served on the faculty of DTS since 1987. Dr. Wallace has traveled around the world to study and photograph biblical manuscripts. He's examined biblical manuscripts at the Ecumenical Patriarchate of Constantinople, the monastery of St. John the Theologian on the island of Patmos, the Vatican, St. Catherine's Monastery at Mount Sinai, and many other sites. He is frequently consulted by the media. He's appeared on television shows such as Day of Discovery and CBN News, and has been a source for stories and publications such as the Wall Street Journal, the Boston Globe, and U.S. News and World Report. He's given over 100 radio interviews. In the scholarly world, he's best known for his extensive work in the areas of biblical Greek grammar and text criticism. His highly acclaimed textbook, Greek Grammar Beyond the Basics, an exegetical syntax of the New Testament, is used in, by one estimate, 2/3 of the biblical Greek classrooms across the country, in places like Yale Divinity School, Princeton Theological Seminary, and abroad in Cambridge University. His textbook on ancient Greek is so good that it's being translated into modern Greek. Just think about that. It's already been translated into Portuguese, Russian, and Spanish. He's the senior editor of the NET Bible, or the New English Translation. This is the first biblical translation to ever be beta tested on the internet. When a preliminary version was posted online for comment, over 1 million people looked at it. If it had been on Facebook, they would have said, like. The NET Bible has nearly 61,000 footnotes, the most of any one-volume Bible translation ever published. Dr. Wallace is the author or co-author of several other books, such as Who's Afraid of the Holy Spirit? An Investigation of the Ministry of the Spirit of God Today, Reinventing Jesus, How Contemporary Skeptics Miss the Real Jesus and Mislead Popular Culture, Dethroning Jesus with Daryl Bach, and The Basics of New Testament Syntax. I was going to say that he's written 8 books, but that's yesterday's count, and it's out of date. His newest book is being released for the first time tonight, Revisiting the Corruption of the New Testament. That title sounds familiar. Revisiting the Corruption of the New Testament, Manuscript, Patristic, and Apocryphal Evidence, released for the first time tonight. In short, Dr. Wallace has thought quite a bit and written quite a lot about the issues under discussion tonight. Dan, welcome to SMU, and let me ask, can we trust the text of the New Testament?
Bart and I have known each other for nearly 30 years. He's had a stellar career in New Testament studies, especially in the field of textual criticism. I have the highest respect for his scholarship. And more than that, I've come to marvel at his quick wit, his impressive rhetoric, and clear communication skills. So I want to begin by saying that I'm deeply honored to share the stage with him tonight. In the appendix to his immensely popular book, Misquoting Jesus, Bart declares, "The facts that I explain about the New Testament in Misquoting Jesus are not at all news to biblical scholars. They are what scholars have known and said for many, many years." He's right. So at the outset, I want to discuss our common ground. There are basically 5 things that we agree on. First of all, the handwritten copies of the New Testament contain a lot of differences. We really are not sure what the number is, but I agree with Bart that there are certainly more differences in the manuscripts than there are words in the New Testament. Secondly, the overwhelming majority of these differences affects virtually nothing. Third, we agree on what we think the wording of the earliest form of the text is, what I will call the autographic, or less accurately but more familiar to you, the original text. We agree on this almost all the time. Fourth, our agreement is even over several well-known and controversial passages, some of which Bart has already mentioned. Mark 16, 9 through 20, for example, where Jesus tells his disciples that they can drink poison and handle snakes and not get hurt. I agree with Bart that this passage is not part of the text that Mark wrote, and my apologies to anyone who has traveled to this debate from West Virginia. We both agree that the story of the woman caught in adultery was not part of the authentic text of John. This passage has more emotional baggage for it than any other. But it has been the pursuit of truth that has led scholars to the near consensus that these 12 verses have no places in the autographic text of John or of any of the four Gospels. Put simply, it's my favorite passage that's not in the Bible. These two passages are far and away the longest disputed texts in our manuscripts. They've been considered inauthentic in virtually all modern translations of the Bible. We both agree on 1 John 5:7. In the King James Bible, it reads, "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one." As Bart said, this would be the most explicit statement about the Trinity in the Bible, but it is definitely not part of the original text. And this fact has been known by scholars for half a millennium. And finally, we both agree that Orthodox scribes occasionally change the New Testament text to bring it more into conformity with their views. So what's the issue then? The text is not the issue. Rather, our disagreement is over two things: how significant these textual variants are, and whether we can have any confidence about recovering the wording of the original. I take the position that we can be relatively confident. I believe that the wording of the originals is not lost, but can be located in the manuscripts. But the question about how certain we can be that we have found it is an entirely different matter. I will also argue that although scribes changed the wording of the text for all sorts of reasons, they were unsuccessful in eradicating the wording of the original. It was both Orthodox scribes and unorthodox who tampered with the text. But how can we be sure that the original wording has not been erased from history, obliterated from all records? Exhibit A is Bart Ehrman's magnificent scholarly tome, The Orthodox Corruption of Scripture. In order for him to locate scribal tampering with the text, he has to know what text has been tampered with. And nowhere in the book does he say, "The original wording is gone," or "We don't have a clue what the autographs say." Just the opposite. Virtually every one of the 300 pages in this book assumes that the autographic wording can be found among the manuscripts, and what's more, that Bart has found it. Well, let me begin with a couple of attitudes that rational people need to avoid. The first is absolute certainty, and the second is total despair or complete skepticism. On the one side are King James-only advocates. They're absolutely certain that the King James Bible in every place exactly represents the original text. I've actually heard them say, "If the King James Bible was good enough for St. Paul, it's good enough for me." And I think that was with a West Virginia accent, too. But this attitude is also one that many church-going, Bible-believing Christians embrace without realizing that their modern translations change with each new edition. On the other side are a few radical scholars who are so skeptical that no piece of data, no hard fact is safe in their hands. It all turns to putty because all views are created equal. If everything is equally possible, then no view is more probable than any other. And their mantra is, "We really don't know what the New Testament originally said, since we no longer possess the originals, and since there could have been tremendous tampering with the text before our existing copies were produced." Such skepticism over recovering the original wording of the New Testament flies in the face of both reason and empirical evidence. These two attitudes, absolute certainty and radical skepticism, are like driving on the mountain roads in Greece, which I have done plenty of times. Drive too far to the left and you'll have a head-on collision with a tourist bus. Drive too far to the right and you will end up flying over the cliff where the guardrail should have been. Rational people recognize that both extremes result in disaster and that the only proper course is one of moderation. There are also four questions that we need to address tonight. How many scribal changes are there, for example? What kinds of textual variants are there? What theological beliefs depend on textually suspect passages? And finally, the bottom line is, can we recover the wording of the original text? I'm going to spend the majority of my time on the first question, the number of differences, but you'll see that this significantly relates to the last question as well. So let me begin with the number of variants, and I want to start with a definition of a textual variant. It's any place among the manuscripts in which there is variation in wording, including word order, omission or addition of words, even spelling differences. The most trivial changes count, and even when all the manuscripts except one say the same thing, that lone manuscript's readings counts as a textual variant. And if 1,000 manuscripts read Jesus in one place and another 1,000 read instead Christ, that also counts as only one variant. The best estimate is that there are between 300,000 and 400,000 textual variants among the manuscripts. And yet there are only about 140,000 words in the New Testament. Now, if this were the only piece of data we had, it would discourage anyone from attempting to recover the wording of the autographs. But that's not the whole story. The reason that we have a lot of variants is that we have a lot of manuscripts. It's simple, really. No classical Greek or Latin text has nearly as many variants because they don't have nearly as many manuscripts. If there were only one copy of the New Testament in existence, it would have zero variants. Yet several ancient authors have only one copy of their writings in existence, and sometimes that lone copy is not produced for more than a millennium. But a lone late manuscript would hardly give us confidence that that single manuscript duplicated the wording of the original in every respect. This was recognized 300 years ago by the brilliant textual scholar Richard Bentley in his work Remarks Upon a Discourse of Free Thinking, which was dealing with John Mill's Greek New Testament with 30,000 variants. And what he said was that if there had been a manuscript, but one manuscript of the Greek Testament at the Restoration of Learning about 2 centuries ago, then we would have had no various readings at all. And would the text be in a better condition then than now that we have 30,000 variant readings? It's good, therefore, to have more anchors than one, and another manuscript to join the first would give more authority as well as security. Bentley penned those comments in 1713 when only 100 Greek New Testament manuscripts had been examined. Today, in Greek alone, we have more than 5,600 manuscripts. Now, many of these are fragmentary, especially the older ones, but the average Greek New Testament manuscript is over 450 pages long. Altogether, there are more than 2.5 million pages of text, which we know quite well at CSNTM because we're trying to photograph all of them, leaving hundreds of witnesses for every book of the New Testament. And Bentley was right. The Greek New Testament of his day has about 5,000 differences from the critically reconstructed New Testament of today. As more and more manuscripts have come to light, we're getting closer and closer to the wording of the autographs. Now, it's not just the Greek manuscripts that count. The New Testament was early on translated into a variety of languages: Latin, Coptic, Syriac, Old Church Slavonic, the list goes on. There are about 10,000 Latin manuscripts of the New Testament alone. No one really knows the number of all these ancient versions, but the best estimates are certainly more than 5,000, plus the 10,000 or so in Latin. Altogether, we have at least 20,000 handwritten manuscripts of the New Testament in various languages. Now, if someone were to destroy all those manuscripts, we would still not be left without a witness. And that's because church fathers wrote commentaries on the New Testament, and they did not have the gift of brevity. To date, approximately 1 million quotations of the New Testament by the fathers have been recorded. If all other sources for our knowledge of the text of the New Testament were destroyed, the patristic quotations would be sufficient alone for reconstruction of practically the entire New Testament, wrote Bruce Metzger and Bart Ehrman. Far more important than the numbers is the date of the manuscripts. How many manuscripts do we have in the first century after the completion of the New Testament? How many in the second, the third? Although the numbers are significantly lower, I think they're still rather impressive. We have today as many as 12 manuscripts from the second century, 64 from the third, and 48 from the fourth. That's a total of 124 manuscripts within 300 years of the composition of the New Testament. Now, most of these are fragmentary, but collectively, the whole New Testament is found in them multiple times. How does the average classical author stack up? If we're comparing the same period, 300 years after composition, the average classical author has no literary remains. Zero. None. Nada. But if we compare all the manuscripts of a particular classical author, regardless of when they were written, the total would still average less than 20, and usually less than a dozen. Stack them all up, and they're about 4 feet high. So how high would the stack of New Testament manuscripts be by comparison? Well, let's take a look. Would that be enough? No, I think we have a few more. Yeah, that's getting better. It's probably not enough. We need to add some more New Testament manuscripts. That's getting better, but it's still not even close to enough. That's still not really there. That's as much as I could do on PowerPoint. That's 1/4 the amount. If you were to put that New Testament stack in one stack, not the 10 that I've got across there, and make it go up as high as it was supposed to, we'd have over a mile of manuscripts compared to 4 feet. Now, perhaps this seems a little bit abstract. Let's use money as an analogy that you can all relate to. If the average ancient author makes $20,000 a year, which is below the poverty level, today that is, the New Testament earns $20 million a year. Skeptics repeatedly note that the vast majority of New Testament manuscripts come from at least 800 years after the completion of the New Testament. The implication they draw from this is that none of these manuscripts are trustworthy, that the New Testament is in no better shape than any other ancient literature. What they don't tell you is that these later manuscripts add only 2% material to the text. If you can envision the New Testament as a snowball rolling down a hill, picking up alien elements through the centuries, it's remarkable that it only picks up 2% more material over 14 centuries. And they don't tell you how this compares to other ancient writers. For many important authors, we only have partial works. Livy and Tacitus were two of the most important Roman historians of the first century CE. We base an awful lot of our understanding of Rome on these two writers. Livy wrote 142 volumes on the history of Rome. Only 25% of them survive today. Only a third of Tacitus' writings are still with us. But we have 200 copies of Pliny the Elder's writings, but we're waiting 700 years for the first one. Plutarch's Lives are found in manuscripts no earlier than 800 years after he wrote. Josephus' Antiquities of the Jews is found in more than 20 copies, none earlier than the 9th century. The earliest copy of Polybius, the historian, was written 1,200 years after he wrote. There are massive gaps in copies of Pausanias' description of Greece, all of them coming more than 1,400 years later. Herodotus' Histories has 26 copies, the earliest coming half a millennium later. But we're waiting 1,500 years for the first substantial copy. We are waiting 18 centuries for any substantial copies of Xenophon's Hellenica. Now, these are not obscure authors. They are some of the most important historians and biographers of the Greco-Roman world. And for some of the better preserved writings, there are gaps galore. One scholar complained that the surviving copies of some of these writings are filled with gaps, corrupt, dislocated, and interpolated. He then proceeds to lay out principles to fill the gaps with nothing but his own reason, because he can't find the original wording in any manuscript. Another scholar notes that for the manuscripts of his author, the chief blemishes are gaps in the text where the manuscript tradition fails us entirely. The task of filling the gaps without manuscript testimony is absolutely necessary for most of Greco-Roman literature and almost entirely unknown for the New Testament. Let me repeat that. The task of filling the gaps without manuscript testimony is absolutely necessary for most of Greco-Roman literature and almost entirely unknown for the New Testament. Skeptics also don't tell you how many New Testament manuscripts we have in those earlier centuries. I've already mentioned the data on the first three centuries. Here are the statistics through 900 CE. Here are the statistics for the 900 CE. We have at least three times more New Testament manuscripts today within the first 200 years than the average Greco-Roman author has in 2,000 years. Although only 10% of the Greek New Testament manuscripts were copied before 900, that's still more than 500 manuscripts. To argue that we don't have very many New Testament manuscripts from the early centuries is only true in relation to later New Testament manuscripts, not to anything else in the ancient world. Even J.K. Eliot, a meticulous New Testament textual critic who happens to be a non-Christian, correctly notes, "We have many manuscripts." He noted some other things too, but not that. Mark, I lost a battery. Never should have quoted Eliot. I knew that was a risk. Well, Bart is right, however, that New Testament scholars have a serious problem on their hands, but it's not the problem that plagues Greco-Roman scholars. New Testament scholars are confronted with an embarrassment of riches. If we have doubts about what the original New Testament said, those doubts would have to be multiplied at least 1,000-fold for the average classical author. Now think about that. Are the skeptics really going to say that they have no idea what Plato or Demosthenes or Suetonius wrote? If they apply their skepticism of the New Testament text to the rest of Greco-Roman literature, then we might as well kiss all our ancient history books goodbye, because we would know next to nothing about the Caesars, Alexander the Great, Cicero, Plato, the glory that was Rome, or millions of other facts that these ancient manuscripts tell us. Our modern democracy, medical ethics, mathematics would all be eradicated. And most importantly, Russell Crowe could never have played the lead role in Gladiator. This kind of skepticism would thrust us right back into the Dark Ages, where ignorance was anything but bliss. Put simply, the New Testament is far and away the best attested work of the ancient world. And precisely because we have hundreds of thousands of variants and hundreds of early manuscripts, we're in an excellent position for recovering the wording of the original. To speak about the number of variants without also speaking about the number of manuscripts is an irresponsible appeal to sensationalism. Now we get to the second section, the nature of the variants. What kinds of variants are there in the manuscripts? Well, more than 99% make virtually no difference at all. For example, the most common variant involves spelling. And this is... Sorry about that. Spent a little time at TCU today. The absolutely most common textual variant is what's called a movable new. That's N at the end of a word when the next word starts with a vowel, like our word a book, an apple, same kind of principle. Or at TCU they say an book, a apple. Well, then there's alterations that cannot be translated. They can't be translated because Greek is a highly inflected language. You can put three words, Jesus loves Paul, in any order you want in a sentence, and it can mean exactly the same thing. Word order has to do with emphasis, but not meaning, because of the inflections on the ends of the words. But not only does Greek have a highly inflected language, it also uses the definite article, the word the, in ways that we don't use it in English. You could say, the Joseph and the Mary went to Jerusalem, as Luke does in chapter 3 of his gospel. We would say Joseph and Mary, not the Joseph and the Mary. That sounds like a doofus. But that's ancient Greek, and that's how it was. Now, I wrote my master's thesis on when the article does not occur in the Greek New Testament. I wrote my doctoral dissertation on when the definite article does occur in the Greek New Testament. These two works could cure the most hopeless insomniac. And I still don't know why the is used with proper names. It may be significant, and it's a lot of textual problems that have that, but it's not that significant. So here's how many ways you can say Jesus loves Paul in Greek. Please write this down because it will be on the test. 8 different ways you can say it. Oh, here's another 8 ways you can say it. Now, if you factor in different spellings for these words, or what's called nomina sacra, or particles that typically are not translated, there are literally hundreds of ways to say Jesus loves Paul in Greek, where every single time it's translated exactly the same in English. Now, if a 3-word sentence like this could potentially be expressed by hundreds of Greek constructions, how should we view the number of actual variants in the New Testament manuscripts? that there are only three variants for every word in the New Testament when the potential is almost infinitely greater seems trivial, especially when we consider how many thousands of manuscripts there are. The smallest group of variants are those that are both meaningful and viable. Less than 1% of all textual variants fit this group. Let me just give you a couple examples. Bart went over some major ones that we both would agree on. Mark chapter 9, verse 29. Jesus is talking to his disciples after they tried to exorcise a demon, and they came back in utter failure, and he said, "This kind cannot come out except by prayer." Well, some manuscripts, including some very early manuscripts, say, "and fasting." So, here's a significant issue. If you are in the business of demon exorcism, you want to know, some of these stubborn demons, do you have to cast them out with just prayer, or is fasting also necessary? Now, you can tell just by looking at me that I go with a shorter reading. Then there's Revelation chapter 13, verse 18. This is a verse everybody knows. We all know that the number of the beast is 666. Ask anybody at SMU, what's the number of the Antichrist? 666. They don't even need to wake up to tell you that. Well, not so fast. In the 1840s, a German scholar went to Paris to decipher a manuscript that it was extraordinarily difficult to read. And it took him almost 2 years to work through the entire thing. But he got to Revelation 13, 18, and he noticed that in this manuscript it said 616 was the number of the beast. Now, most scholars think that 666 is the number of the beast and 616 is the neighbor of the beast. He just lives a few doors down, I guess. But then at the end of the 20th century at Oxford University, they discovered another fragment, a papyrus, that happens to be the oldest fragment of this particular passage. The one that Constantine von Tischendorf discovered or deciphered in Paris was our second most important manuscript for Revelation. The one at Oxford, our oldest for this particular chapter. Those two manuscripts may well tell us what the original wording is for this particular passage. Now, is it important? Yes, I think it's extraordinarily important, especially if it gets into modern English translations, because if you start having 616 as the number of the beast, it will send about 7 tons of popular Christian literature to the flames. Although the quantity of textual variants among the New Testament manuscripts numbers in the hundreds of thousands, those that change the meaning pale in comparison. Less than 1% of the differences are both meaningful and viable. There are still hundreds of texts that are in dispute. I don't want to give the impression that textual criticism is merely a mopping up job nowadays, that all but a handful of problems have been resolved. That's not the case. There are hundreds of passages whose interpretation depends to some degree on which reading is followed. Well, finally, or next to last, we ask the question, what theological beliefs depend on textually suspect passages? In the appendix to Misquoting Jesus, there is a Q&A section. The most telling question asked of Bart is this: why do you believe that these core tenets of Christian orthodoxy to be in jeopardy based on the scribal errors you discovered in the biblical manuscripts? Now, Bart's response may surprise you. Essential Christian beliefs are not affected by textual variants in the manuscript tradition of the New Testament. Suffice it to say that viable textual variants that disturb essential Christian beliefs found in the New Testament have not yet been produced. And finally, the bottom line: can we recover the wording of the autographs? I offer 4 arguments briefly that we can be relatively certain that we can recover the wording of the autographs. And first is a nice little quotation from Bart that I want to begin with, which he's mentioned already. Not only do we not have the originals, we don't have the first copies of the originals. We don't even have copies of the copies of the originals or copies of the copies of the copies of the originals. You could probably put that to a tune. I like it. Well, first of all, this is probably true, but we really can't be certain about it. We can't be dogmatic if that's the case. But let's assume that it's true, but if it is, it's not the whole truth. The impression one gets from the statement is that the transmission of the New Testament is like the telephone game. It's a game that every child knows. You whisper something into somebody's ear, it goes down through 10 or 12 people, and then that last person spits it out to the whole crowd, and everybody laughs because the message got totally garbled. There's absolutely no motivation to get it right. But copying of New Testament manuscripts is hardly like this parlor game. First of all, the message is passed on in writing, not just orally. Secondly, textual critics do not rely on just the last person, but can examine the work of several scribes who are closer to the original source. Third, patristic writers are commenting on the text as it's going through its transmissional history. And when there are chronological gaps among the manuscripts, and we have quite a few, these writers often fill in those gaps by telling us what the text said in that place in their day. And finally, in the telephone game, once the story is told by one person, that individual has nothing else to do with it. It's out of his or her hands. But the original New Testament books were almost surely copied more than once and probably several times. And they were probably consulted even after a few generations of copies had already been produced. My second argument is that Barth speaks of the first 200 years of copying as uncontrolled, giving the impression that all manuscripts of this era were riddled with mistakes, both unintentional and intentional. The scribes, it seems, were undisciplined and wild, freely adding or subtracting words whenever they wanted to. But this is not the whole story. The standard introduction to New Testament textual criticism puts things in perspective. It would be a mistake to think that the uncontrolled copying practices that led to the formation of the Western textual tradition were followed everywhere that texts were reproduced in the Roman Empire. In particular, there's solid evidence that in at least one major see of early Christendom, the city of Alexandria, there was conscious and conscientious control exercised in the copying of the books of the New Testament. Textual witnesses connected to Alexandria attest a high quality of textual transmission from the earliest times. It was there that a very ancient line of text was copied and preserved. These words are found in the fourth edition of the Text of the New Testament by Bruce Metzger and Bart Ehrman. Now, we can illustrate the quality of the Alexandrian manuscripts with two manuscripts that Bart and I would both agree are two of the very best New Testament manuscripts we have, if not the two best, Papyrus 75 and Codex Vaticanus, also known as B. Their agreement is higher than that of any other two early manuscripts. P75 is 100 to 150 years older than B, and yet it is not an ancestor of B. Instead, B copied from an earlier common ancestor that both B and P75 were related to. The combination of both of these manuscripts in a particular reading goes back most likely to early in the second century. And third, the standard Greek New Testament in use today is known as the Nestle Aulon text. It not only produces what the editors believe is the wording of the original New Testament, but also lists tens of thousands of variants. Here's a picture of the text. They list 116 places where scholars over the centuries have thought that none of the Greek manuscripts have the original wording. If the manuscripts were so corrupt from very early times, then we would have a terribly corrupt text where we wouldn't have a clue what the original wording was in hundreds and hundreds of places. There's 116 that the editors list. They accept only one. The addition of a single letter to the end of a word in Acts 16:12. And yet two of the editors, Kurt Aulond and Bruce Metzger, felt that even in that one place, the original wording was to be found among the manuscripts. What Aulon and Metzger were arguing is that when it comes to the wording of the New Testament, it can be found either above the line or below the line in the Nestle Aulon text. In other words, the autographic text is found in A, B, or C, never none of the above. Finally, we can say even more. The vast majority of New Testament scholars believe that the wording of the autographs is not only recoverable, but that we have recovered it in most places. Total skepticism is uncalled for. In Exhibit A are Barth's many books on the New Testament. In these books, he presupposes knowledge of the wording of the autographs. Here are just some of the titles that you can see. Notice, Orthodox Corruption of Scripture, Misquoting Jesus. The Text of the New Testament, Its Transmission, Corruption, and Restoration. And Forged, Writing in the Name of God, Why the Bible's Authors Are Not Who We Think They Are. Take just the last book, published earlier this year, as an illustration. In Forged, Bart argues that Paul did not write 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, or Titus, collectively known as the pastoral epistles. One of his arguments is that the vocabulary of these letters is not the same as what we find in Paul's authentic letters. Now, in order for him to make that claim, he has to know what the words are in Paul's other letters, as well as what the words are in the pastoral letters. Regardless of what some of us may think about his argument in Forged, this book simply could not have been written unless Bart was sure about the wording of the original text in almost every place. And the same is true for all his books on the New Testament. Is what we have now what the New Testament authors wrote nearly 2,000 years ago? It almost certainly is in all essentials. Even in most particulars, we can be relatively sure. To be uber skeptical about this in the face of the mountain of evidence is to take a leap of faith where the guardrail should have been. It is far more reasonable to be relatively sure that we can recover the wording of the original New Testament text than to be radically skeptical about the entire endeavor. Thank you for your attention.
At this point, we'll have two rounds of response. Professor Ehrman will have a chance to respond and raise questions, followed by Dr. Wallace, followed by Dr. Ehrman, followed by Dr. Wallace. Each round of response will last for approximately 5 or 6 minutes. And Bart, we'll begin with you.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Dan, for that very informative and hilarious presentation. It's a very impressive statement, and I think Dallas is well served to have such a competent textual critic in its midst. Two things struck me about Dan's presentation. One was, lost in my notes. One was how much we agree on many important points. The other was how little, it seems to me, he's addressed the real problem. One of the strategies that Dan has used is to quote some of my earlier books, some of which were written nearly 20 years ago, claiming that I obviously do believe that we can achieve the original text. I've changed my mind on that question. I simply, for the reason that I've given you, we don't have evidence that can tell us whether we know about the original New Testament, and I was a little bit disappointed in seeing that Dan didn't provide any evidence. I'll bring that up again at the very end of my closing remarks here. First, I want to make a couple of comments about things that he really stressed that struck me as really irrelevant. First, Dan wants to stress that the reason we have so many variants is because we have so many manuscripts, and we have all of these patristic authors who quote the New Testament. We have lots and lots of witnesses. I agree, but that's not relevant. Yes, that's why we have so many variant readings, but what about the manuscripts we don't have from the early centuries? He says we have 124 manuscripts within the first 300 years, and the New Testament is replicated many times in those manuscripts. I'd like to see the evidence of that, actually, that we have the entire New Testament replicated many times in those manuscripts. But even if it's true, what are our earliest witnesses? How many do we have before P45 in the year 220 for the Gospel of Mark? It's 150 years after Mark was originally produced. What manuscripts do we have before that? Dan stresses that we have many more manuscripts of the New Testament than we do have for classical authors, and that if we reject the idea that we can achieve the original text for the New Testament, then how much more for the classical authors? So we may not know what Plato said, or Cicero, or Suetonius, or Tacitus, and he's absolutely right. We may not know. But how does that mean that we do know about the New Testament? It doesn't address the question.
Dan argued that only 1% of our surviving variants matter for anything. Only 1% are meaningful and viable. I don't know if that's true. It might be 1%. Suppose it is 1%. My question does not pertain to the 1%. My question pertains to the textual variants that were introduced into the manuscript tradition before our surviving manuscripts. How many additions were there before our manuscripts? How many omissions were there before our manuscripts? And if he tells us that we know the answer, then I'd like to know how we know the answer. How does he know that the manuscripts were not changed? He agrees with me that there are hundreds of passages that really matter. But then he wants to stress that no essential Christian beliefs are affected, and he quotes me to that effect. That is absolutely true. I don't think that Dan's theology will change, no matter which variants he looks at. But is that how we gauge significance? Does the problem not matter because none of our theological doctrines are changed? Let me give you an analogy. Suppose tomorrow morning we woke up and it turned out that in every Bible throughout the entire world, there was no longer to be found the Gospel of Mark, Paul's letter to the Philippians, or the book of 1 Peter. Which doctrines of the Christian faith would be affected by the loss of those three books? Not a single doctrine. Would it be significant? Yes, it'd be significant. It'd be hugely significant. Significance does not ride on whether essential beliefs are affected. Dan closed his talk by talking about whether we can recover the autographs, and to my thinking, he has not satisfactorily answered the question, and so I'd like him to try again. How do we know that the text was not changed significantly before our earliest surviving manuscripts? What is our basis of knowledge for that? I would like him to address that question, and let me make it more specific. How do we know that our surviving manuscripts were copied from accurate copies instead of thoroughly erroneous ones? I'm not asking whether the later manuscripts, after the year 900, were accurately copying their predecessors. How do we know that our earliest copies were preserving accurate copies of accurate copies? How do we know that? Dan also says that 99% of our surviving variant readings are insignificant, and so my question is, how many significant variants were created before our surviving manuscripts? And how do you know? If you don't know, then how can you say that we can trust the text of the New Testament? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Dan?
Again, Bart, I thank you for your great questions, which I will perhaps try to answer maybe later. Because I had questions about your presentation as well. You said, for example, maybe Mark was copied only a couple of times. That kind of a scenario for the copying of these manuscripts is absolutely vital for you to come up with the idea that the manuscripts could have been changed multiple times before we get to any of our copies at all. And yet, we see that Paul asks that his letters get circulated to various churches, and so people were making copies of his letters. We see that Matthew and Luke both used Mark. And consequently, it must have been copied a couple of times, at least, just for them to use it. It's rather doubtful to suppose that these books, most of them, probably even some of them, were not copied multiple times from the original manuscript itself. In your book, Misquoting Jesus, you said that 1 Thessalonians may have been read so many times that it simply wore out and deteriorated. You didn't say that it could have been read and copied so many times that it wore out and deteriorated. So I give my evidence again. It is not proof. And I'm not the one who says that I know something. You're the one who says that you know that you can't know. I'm the one who's saying, I think we have probability on our side. And we have good reason to come to grips with this. And you can compare this with the Greco-Roman literature and recognize that the New Testament itself is in much, much better shape than those other documents in terms of giving us what the text of the church believed in. And then you have the early church apostolic fathers and other groups that write about this stuff, and the patristic writers that are commenting on the text, early versions, some of which go back to the second or third century, and then they take on a life of their own that's no longer intersecting with the Greek text. Those become, in a sense, an early manuscript that we can look at. One of the problems you've got in your presentation, I think, is you want to say we don't know what the errors were that were created. It went all over the map. Well, if it went all over the map, we would have such incredible chaos. How in the world could those manuscripts have been utterly destroyed so that all we have left are those that seem to fit into orthodoxy as far as what you even confessed, that no essential belief of the Christian faith is affected by any of our extant manuscripts? You also said the earliest scribes made a number of mistakes in their copies and that they were, in fact, the worst scribes we have. I'd like to ask you how you know that. Our earliest scribes, we have as many as 12 manuscripts from the second century. And by the way, you asked about how many we have in terms of a multiplicity of that. And you've asked before, what's my basis for that information? The Kurzgefasste says that there are 10 manuscripts from the second century or on the cusp of the second and third century. And Eldon Epp, in one of his recent articles, actually added one more. He went to 11. I've looked at what T.C. Skeet has said about some of these things. Comfort and Barrett, I think they go way too liberal in terms of giving an early date for the manuscripts, but I've added one more. My number is less than what many people would have. It's one more than what Eldon Epp has. And it's 13 more than what he has through the fourth century. 124 manuscripts I've got, he's got 111. Now, you talk about these early scribes not being literary scribes, not being trained scribes, and then you talk about the ones who are trained, which are in the Middle Ages. That is certainly true. But so is the scribe of Sinaiticus in the fourth century. So is the scribe of Vaticanus in the fourth century. In fact, so is the scribe of P66, in the second century. And that scribe did his work, according to E.C. Caldwell, in a scriptorium where his primary concern was to make pretty letters. He made a lot of mistakes. There's another manuscript that's almost as old as that, P75, that we know was not produced in a scriptorium, not by a professional scribe. It looks like chicken scratches almost. It's legible, but it's certainly not pretty. But that scribe copied out his manuscript one letter at a time. And you and Dr. Metzger both said that P75 and B together attest to a very early tradition, a very ancient tradition. So what I am saying about what I probably know, not certainly know, is what you and Dr. Metzger said in 2005 in the fourth edition of the text of the New Testament. The other thing, though, on these early scribes is that P75 was written in what's called a documentary hand. A scribe who writes in a documentary hand means that he's not trained to be a literary scribe copying literature, but he is trained to be a bureaucrat, a CPA, a bean counter. Those scribes were meticulous, and one of the great pieces of evidence to demonstrate that our manuscripts come back from these documentary hands is the use of numbers in the manuscripts. We don't see this in the more literary manuscripts. What we see is the numbers spelled out, while as in the documentary hands, they are not spelled out. P75 was written with a documentary hand. He was an untrained scribe, and yet Bart agrees that that's one of the very best manuscripts we have of the New Testament. The last question is, when you speak about these manuscripts and the mistakes that they made, what kinds of mistakes are you talking about? In those early centuries, you said that the mistakes that they made were mistakes that were accidental, not intentional. Those are the easiest mistakes you mentioned to discern. Let me give one example as I wrap up, and that is, in one manuscript, John 1:30, it says, has John the Baptist say, after me comes heir. Well, that doesn't make much sense. The Greek word that he miswrote was aner, which means man. After me comes a man. Now, that's a nonsense reading, but I think the next scribe would know, hey, this must mean aner, after me comes a man, speaking about Jesus. Now, if you don't believe that Jesus ever existed, you would not call that a nonsense error. After me comes error, Jesus didn't exist as far as you're concerned. But I think it is a nonsense error and easily corrected by the next scribe. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, this is getting good. We'll have one more round of debate. Bart, it's your turn.
Okay, thank you very much. So, I'm looking forward to Dan's answers to my questions. Dan raised several questions for me that are they're very good questions, and I certainly want to deal with them. Dan raises the question, how do I know that Mark was only copied a couple of times? That's his first question to me, and I don't know. I don't know whether it was copied twice, or five times, or 500 times. I don't know, and neither does Dan. Were the first copies accurate? I don't know, and neither does Dan. Were the copies of those copies accurate? I don't know, and neither does Dan. How do we know that the earliest copyists were accurately representing the text that they had in front of them? There is simply no way to know. Dan once again reverts to the fact that our manuscript evidence for the New Testament is so much better than for the Greco-Roman, other Greco-Roman literature. And once again, we're in agreement on this. Yes, we have far more manuscripts for the New Testament than for any other book from the ancient world. Yes. Is that relevant to the question we're talking about tonight? No. The question is, can we trust that we really know what was in the original copies of Mark and the other books of the New Testament? Dan wants to label me as a radical skeptic, and I'm simply saying that we have no evidence. If he thinks that there is evidence, I want to know what the evidence is. And so why doesn't he tell us the evidence that the earliest scribes, on which our later scribes depended, copied their text accurately? How do we know that the earliest copies of Mark did not take out a verse or two they didn't like, or add a verse or two that they thought should be in there? How do we know that they didn't do that? We have no way of knowing that. And so I'd like to know why Dan thinks that we do know. Dan does ask a very good question. How do we know that our earliest scribes were the worst scribes? And so it works like this. If you take two manuscripts from the 12th century and carefully compare them with one another, word for word, they very often will agree in the vast majority of cases. If you take a manuscript from the 2nd century or the 3rd century and compare it with an 11th century manuscript, there will be enormous differences, tons of differences. Why? Because the later scribes were trained to copy things accurately. The earlier scribes were not. And not only are the early manuscripts more different than the later ones, and the later ones are from one another, the early manuscripts, when you compare them carefully with one another, word for word, are greatly different from one another. And so Dan mentioned, for example, two manuscripts, P66 and P75. They're closely related, with hundreds and hundreds of differences between them. He really does not want to use P66 as an example of a manuscript that is done by a competent scribe. Yes, he makes pretty letters, and he makes hundreds of mistakes.
as detailed in the thorough examination of Gordon Fee, which has been published as a book and that Dan knows all about. This is an example of a scribe who made tons of mistakes. Now, our earliest scribes clearly show that they're not trained to copy manuscripts the way monks were in later monasteries. When you go back to the 4th century, he mentions Codex Sinaiticus and Codex B, and he says these are very good manuscripts, which is, of course, what I myself said and that I agree with. By the 4th century, you start getting good manuscripts, but you start looking at the earlier manuscripts, and they're not nearly as good. The earlier manuscripts are copied by scribes who are not trained. What about the manuscripts that preceded those manuscripts? What about the scribes who were copying the text not in the year 350, but in the year 80? What assurance do we have that those scribes were good when the trend is that the earlier you go, the worse the scribes are? What happens when you go to a period earlier than our surviving manuscripts, to a period where scribes are copying before our surviving scribes were copying? Are you telling me that those earlier scribes are more likely to be accurate than the 3rd and 4th century scribes? On what grounds do we say that? What is the evidence? That's what I'm asking for, is the evidence. Let me try once more with my questions. How do we know, or rather, how does Dan know, that our surviving manuscripts were copied from accurate copies instead of thoroughly erroneous ones? How does he know that? And when Dan says that 99% of our surviving variant readings are insignificant, my second question is, how many variants were created before our surviving manuscripts? And how many of those variant readings were significant? If he says he doesn't know, then I want to know how he can say that he can trust the text of the New Testament. Thank you.
We'll conclude our round of responses with Dan.
Again, lively questions, Bart, while still skirting the issues that I raised with you, but that seems to be the way we're doing this tonight. We don't have hard evidence that you're asking for. That's what we both agree on. We do not have the hard evidence, but we have a great deal of soft evidence that, in all probability, leads to the conviction that what we have in our hands is, in all essential respects, what the New Testament writers actually wrote. I could illustrate it this way. Bart keeps talking about these early scribes that made mistakes left and right, and we have no idea if they were accurate copies or not. Well, let's just suppose I took 20 of you, and we met in a room, and I read out to you the text of the Gospel of Mark. Many of you would make some very egregious errors. All of you would make mistakes. How in the world could anybody get back to the text that I read to you? Well, that's what Bart and I both know very well how to do. It's known as textual criticism. We examine these manuscripts, we can compare the manuscripts so that we can see this reading came from this, it's an errant reading that was due to this kind of mistake. We can compare the manuscripts in terms of which ones are sloppier, which ones tend to be more accurate, and the basis that they have. We can do it through several generations of copies. In fact, I do an exercise that I've done now 70 times in churches all over the country and, in fact, in the world. It's called The Gospel According to Snoopy. I wanted to use a mild name so that we could play it pretty well. We get 50 people, 22 of whom are scribes. I give them a passage to copy out in English, and each scribe has instructions. One scribe has the instructions, you're making theological changes. Another one, you have bad hearing and you're hearing this in the scriptorium. Another one, you're a terrible speller. Another one, you have no idea how to write so that anybody could even read what you're saying. I have done this exercise 70 times over the last 35 years with lay people, with people who know nothing about textual criticism except what I tell them the hour on Friday night when we begin. The scribes copy out the text. Saturday morning, everybody else comes together, and on the basis of thinking through the issues of the external evidence and the internal evidence and the relationship that these scribes have to each other, with the earliest manuscripts all gone. They work through that to try to get back to the original wording of the gospel, according to Snoopy. Over the years, almost every single time we've done this, there have been no more than one or two mistakes. There has never been a serious change in the text, something like to versus also, those kinds of changes. These are people who don't know anything about textual criticism. They have the same kind of a situation that New Testament scholars are facing, and we are trying to put this together on the basis of probability. I give them an hour instruction on Friday night, and then I let them decide how to go about getting back to the original with no instruction. They have to do it on their own. And they debate in groups, they get back together. It's about a 4 or 5 hour project. Over a dozen times, they have exactly duplicated the wording of the original text. The worst group I ever had was Dallas Seminary doctoral students, but I don't want to talk about them. I think they missed it by 4 words. Bart, you talk about the worst scribes. And you say it's the earliest scribes that are the worst. And the way you can tell is because you can compare them to an 11th century scribe that's very accurate. I don't think that you're trying to say, in fact, I know you're not trying to say, that the text of the 11th century manuscript, which is almost surely going to be Byzantine, is better than the early Alexandrian manuscripts. What you're trying to say, I think, is that these manuscripts that you consider to be the worst manuscripts are that they are not done by professional scribes, and consequently, they have mistakes in them. But even then, I have to ask, what manuscripts are you talking about? I don't think it's the second century manuscripts. We have 4 fragments of the book of Acts and elsewhere in Western manuscripts in the 3rd century. We have part of a gospel in the late fourth century that has the Western text, and then we have a gospel's manuscript in the 5th century that's Western. That would be the wild copying texts. But the Alexandrian manuscripts do not greatly differ from one another, as you suggest, except in those incidental errors. My evidence for this is Dr. Tim Finney's doctoral dissertation on Hebrews. He's from Perth, Australia, and he demonstrated that the early manuscripts have incidental errors for the book of Hebrews. And Barbara Allon, the former director of the Institute for New Testament Lückentextforschung in Münster, the flagship institute for text critical studies, recently wrote an article in which she looked at the early manuscripts for John, and she said, they really are very similar to each other, except for the kinds of mistakes that we can determine what's going on. I think that you're trying to suggest, Bart, that out of chaos, we get this order, when the chaos, actually, of all these manuscripts we possibly could start with, would only end up in us having variants where we could get back to the original just exactly as we do today. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks to both of you. Now, I know that many of you have been looking forward to a time when you could ask your own questions, and we'll now move into a time for about 30 minutes.
So the unspoken premise of the debate question is the New Testament itself. How is that constructed? I'm talking of the canon of the New Testament, sort of assuming that what we know of today as the New Testament was what was sort of in circulation by the original Christian church. We've since found a number of other documents and other writings that were sort of in circulation but didn't make it into the final cut of the canon. Is there anything that we can learn by textual criticism of those works that would help to inform understanding of what we consider now the canonical New Testament?
Yeah, I can deal with that quickly.
Go ahead, and I'll follow up.
Yeah. It's just we don't have as many manuscripts as most of these for most of these other non-canonical works, but there are some that we have a lot. I mean, the Protoevangelium Jacobi, the Proto-Gospel of James, was a very popular book through the Middle Ages, and we have 500 some manuscripts of it in the various vernaculars of Europe. And what we find in the case of these non-canonical books is exactly what we find in the case of the canonical books. Scribes made a lot of changes, sometimes intentionally and sometimes unintentionally. So they didn't copy the New Testament manuscripts any better than they copied the others.
I'd say they copied them worse. We have some evidence that's been done by Martin Haida on the Shepherd of Hermas, and it's copying history. He said it's much worse than the text of the New Testament. And we have evidence on the Gospel of Thomas in this new book that has just come out today that I've edited, Revisiting the Corruption of the New Testament. Mr. Tim Raschuti wrote a chapter comparing the Coptic text of the Gospel of Thomas with the three Greek fragments that we have, a text-critical comparison, and what he noticed is that there are pretty radical differences within a 100-year period of time, and the extrapolation is that it's much worse than what we seem to have for New Testament manuscripts.
Thank you.
Over here, a question for Dan or for both.
Dr. Ehrman, I'm wondering if we can't get back to an autographic reading of the New Testament, then how do you envision the aims of textual criticism in the first place? What's the point of textual criticism if we can't get back to an autographic reading?
Thank you. It's a great question. And this is where I'm going to disagree strongly with something that Dan said. When Dan said that the vast majority of textual critics think that we can get back to the originals, as Dan knows full well, the term original text is generally not used anymore by textual critics. If you go to the SBL, the Society of Biblical Literature section on textual criticism, where scholars from around the world come together, scholars have gotten away from using the term original text for many of the reasons that I've laid out for you. The very center of textual research at Münster, Germany, which is there are two major centers of textual research in Europe. One is in Münster, Germany, one is in Birmingham, England. And both of them have gotten away from talking about the original text. So what they tend to talk about instead is, how do you translate it, Dan? Hausgang's text.
Exit
text. Yes, thank you. What we try to reconstruct is the text from which the surviving witnesses descend. And we don't know whether that text that we reconstruct is the original or not. That's all we can do. We can only reconstruct the earliest form of the text. And whether it's the original or not, Dan says yes, and I say I don't know.
Let me respond to that, too. What I did not say is that the vast majority of textual critics are trying to get back to or think they can get back to the original text. What I said is that the vast majority of New Testament scholars think that it has been largely recovered.
And
it's based on all the writings that they do when you talk about redaction criticism in the Synoptic Gospels. It's assuming, that what Mark says, what Matthew says, those kinds of things.
Yeah,
virtually all New Testament scholarship for the last 2,000 years has assumed that we can recover it in all essentials. And I think even in the most corrupt text, we have it in its essentials.
I agree. We probably have it in its probably. It's a probability judgment. But it's not true. I mean, it's true that for 2,000 years people have thought that, but the last 20 years you won't find text critics talking about the original text, will you?
You actually will. They will talk about it in terms of using the Ausgangstext, initial text, autographic text, that kind of terminology, because of Eldon Epps' article that says there's problems with using the term original text. But J.K. Eliot still thinks we're going back to the original text, even though he doesn't call it that. You said in a debate with somebody else that it's only evangelicals who are speaking about it. That's not true. Holger Strutwolf, the director of the Institute in Münster, says that we are trying to get back to the original text. Gerd Mink, who's in Münster, also said there's no difference between the initial text and the autographic text.
These are not that, evangelicals. Dan, this just isn't right. It's not true. The initial text is not the original text. That's why they started talking about the initial text, because we can't get to the original text. Otherwise, they would not have changed the language. You know full well, when the Ollins first published their book on the text of the New Testament, they used the term original text, and the Ollins changed it. They don't talk about the original text anymore, and either do the people at Birmingham or their successors in Munster. They might, for practical purposes, say, well, you know, it's as close as we get to the original, but we don't know whether it's the original. That's why they don't use the term.
Have you read what Holger Strutwolf has said about this?
Of course, he's not a textual critic, is he?
He's the director of the center, though.
Yes, he's the director of the center, but he's not a trained textual critic, and he explicitly uses the term Ausgangs text. He doesn't use original text.
But he is still assuming that that is the same as what we used to refer to as the original text.
No.
And Gerd Mink said the same thing in the colloquium 2 years ago to textual critics,
no,
which you were not able to be at.
Well, gentlemen, I'm going to ask you to put this in the form of a question. No, this is why I came tonight, honestly.
Can I
you will
something?
Have an opportunity to return to this in your closing statements. So in the meantime, let's now switch back over to our questioners in the audience. Yes, sir.
So kind of along those same lines, if it's not the case that there was this massive recension at some point trying to get all the manuscripts on the same track, and it's also the case that there was wild copying going on, especially the earlier, the more wild, why is there so much verbal agreement between Matthew, Mark, and Luke in, you know, leading to the synoptic problem?
Are you asking me or Dan?
Either's fine.
Either or both?
I don't even understand the difference.
Wow.
Mark, go ahead and I'll follow.
Okay. So, yeah, you know, one of the problems is that Matthew and Mark and Luke often disagree as well as often they agree. And one of the questions that have been thrown out in scholarship is whether Matthew and Luke actually had the same form of Mark in front of them or not. Are the differences, sometimes Mark and Matthew will agree against Luke, sometimes Mark and Luke will agree against Matthew, and there are times when all three of them disagree. And so there are scholars who think that one of the way you can explain this part of the so-called synoptic problem, is that Matthew and Luke had different forms of Mark in front of them, which is also what I think, yeah.
Let me answer it as well. I think there is a method, and you told me, Bart, at dinner last night about a doctoral student who's doing, trying to figure out what Matthew's form of
Mark
would be.
Yeah.
I think there is a way, actually, to do that. It takes a lot of time, and I don't know if it could be done in just a doctoral dissertation. What you do is you look at the text that Matthew has of Mark, where you've got the double tradition, and where the text that he follows does not fit in line with his redactional purposes, but seems to go against that, then that must almost surely have come from an intermediate text that was corrupt.
Yeah.
Now, I do not believe that the text that Matthew and Luke each had of Mark was absolutely pristine. Every single thing we know about the copy to manuscripts is that they made mistakes. But I have been spending the last several years trying to find where there's something in Matthew that would not go along with his redactional purposes in his change of Mark. I can't find it. That tells me that it wasn't the scribe before him who corrupted the text, but he, because he's doing it for theological reasons and historical reasons, is changing it. So I don't think Matthew and Luke are at all like the earlier scribes that we have before them or the scribes that come later.
Can I just ask real quick, between what we have, the strong evidence that we have that's been presented, and the original autographs, what would it be in between that that would convince you that it's trustworthy, other than the autographs?
Well, if we had early copies, if we had copies of Mark, suppose next week there's an archaeological find in Egypt, say it's in Rome, and we have reason to think that these 10 manuscripts that are discovered were all copied within a week of the original copy of Mark, and they disagree in 0.001% of their textual variation, then I would say that's good evidence. And that's precisely what we don't have.
Thank you.
Wow.
Yes.
Good evening, Dr. Ehrman. There was one argument that Dr. Wallace presented that was not addressed, and not specifically, he mentioned that the New Testament has more manuscripts than any average classical piece of work that we have today. With following the question that the young man in front of me asked, what type of evidence would convince you, and you answered that. So with that type of standard of requirement for evidence, how then, in your opinion, should we regard classical pieces of work today of which we don't have original autographs or even not even half near the number of manuscripts for them, like the Odyssey and things like that, that we were required to read in high school? And
yes, right, yeah, so you wasted your time, I'm sorry. So, no, I tried to address that. I'm sorry if it didn't come through clearly, but I certainly wanted to address that and tried to address it, is that it's absolutely true. We have far more manuscripts of the New Testament than we have of Homer or Plato or Euripides or Aeschylus or Sophocles or any of these authors. Absolutely true. What that mean, that does not mean, though, that we have the original New Testament. What it means is that we have more manuscripts of the New Testament than these other works, and it's harder to reconstruct these other works even than it is of the New Testament. And this isn't a disputed point. I mean, classicists agree that in many places we have problems. One difference is that the most of these classical authors, scribes, did not make intentional changes because of their particular beliefs. So there are more intentional changes in the New Testament manuscripts because people wanted to make sure it said what they wanted it to say, and so they changed it in places. And that simply didn't happen all that much in Homer and stuff. But scholars have known about problems in Homer since for over 2,000 years. There were scholars who were devoted to the problem of trying to reconstruct the text of Homer, realizing that, in fact, ultimately it was an impossible task. So, yes, I mean, it's an impossible task with the classics, but that doesn't mean that therefore it's possible with the New Testament.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry we don't have time for all of these questions, but thanks to all of you who participated. At this point, we're going to move to closing statements. We'll begin with Bart, and then we will allow Dan to give his closing statement.
Well, thank you all very much again for being here. This has been a very lively back and forth, and I've enjoyed it very much. I want to say that I am not at the end of the day, I'm not a complete skeptic about the New Testament. I think historians have to weigh probabilities. Is it probable that the Gospel of Mark that we have today is completely unlike anything that Mark really wrote? No, it's not probable. Do we know that it's exactly what Mark wrote? No, we don't know that either. We just don't know. How different is Mark from the original Mark? We don't know. What if it's only 3 or 4% different? Isn't that good enough? Well, it might be good enough for some people, but you know, what if you knew that you could trust your spouse 97% of the time? Is that good enough? With the New Testament, we're often talking about more than 3% or 4%. For example, there are two forms of the book of Acts in the manuscript tradition. We have two forms of the book of Acts. One manuscript tradition is 12.5% longer than the other. 12.5% longer. We're not talking about 3 or 4% in every instance. Dan himself admits that there are hundreds of places where we don't know. And that's with the evidence that we do have. What do we have with the evidence we don't have? I don't know, and neither does Dan. And you will note that he hasn't answered my questions. Let me try and give an analogy. The topic has to do with whether we can trust the text of the New Testament. And in my view, when it comes to matters of trust, the burden of proof resides with the person who says that we can trust. Give you an analogy. There's a bridge that's built over a mile-high ravine, and a debate is going on over whether a passenger train should pass over the bridge, whether it can in fact bear the weight of a passenger train that has 100 people on board. Do both sides of that debate share the burden of proof? No. In that case, the train's engineer will not take the train onto the bridge until he's convinced that he can trust the weight. In issues of trust, it's the person who says that you can trust who bears the burden of proof. How can we know that the earliest copyists in the first 200 years of copying the New Testament were skilled and careful or good at all? How do we know that our earliest manuscripts are based on high-quality exemplars? In other words, that the manuscript is based on a manuscript that's accurate. How do we know that, especially given the fact that in our earliest manuscripts, we have more mistakes than we have in our later manuscripts? The early scribes were not as trained and not as skillful. How about the earlier ones? Maybe they were as good. Maybe they weren't. How do we know? Is this a bridge you want to trust? Is this a bridge you're willing to take the train on? Well, I think it's a bona fide question. Let me conclude with a final illustration of the problem. My professor, Bruce Metzger, told the story of his own teacher at Princeton University, a man named Paul Coleman Norton, who was stationed in North Africa during the Second World War, and after the war wrote an article that got published in a scholarly journal about a manuscript that he happened to discover while he was in North Africa in the army during the Second World War. There was some downtime, and he went into a mosque, and the leaders of the mosque told him they had a very ancient book once they found out that he was a professor of ancient history. And so he looked at this ancient book. It was a copy, it was an Arabic copy of the Quran. But he found inside the book, he later indicated in this article, he found a page that was written in Greek. And as he read this page, he realized this was a commentary on the Gospel of Matthew. It was just fragmentary. It was just the one page, but it was stuck in this old manuscript. And so he wrote this article about it in the scholarly journal. And the interesting thing was that it included an important textual variant for the Gospel of Matthew. You know that in the Gospel of Matthew, there's this passage where Jesus is talking about people who will be cast into the outer darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. Well, in this commentary, this ancient commentary on the Gospel of Matthew, there was an additional line. Jesus says, they'll be cast into the outer darkness where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. And the disciples replied, but Master, what of those who have no teeth? Jesus said, teeth will be provided. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bart. We'll allow Dan to have his concluding comments.
That was a great hoax. Great fake manuscript that was produced. Bart gives the illustration of a train, and that the person who argues that you need to trust has the burden of proof. I would argue that all of us are on the mountain road when it comes to thinking about ancient texts, not just the text of the New Testament, but all of Greco-Roman literature. And if we are going to be extremely skeptical and say, we just don't know, then we truly are going back to the Dark Ages, where we know next to nothing about the ancient world, and therefore have no background to understand our modern world. I think a radical position moves to the left or to the right, and either way you get creamed. Only a moderate position is going to say, we don't absolutely know. We definitely don't absolutely know. We're dealing with historical issues here. There's no such thing as absolute certainty about these kinds of things, at least not on a historical level. But what there is probability. Does it matter if Jesus forgave a woman caught in adultery? Of course it matters. And Bart and I both agree that we are pretty darn sure John didn't write that story. Does it matter if Jesus was angry when he healed a leper? Of course that matters. And Bart and I, again, are both in agreement that most likely Mark wrote that when Jesus did this, he was angry rather than being compassionate. Does it matter if the New Testament explicitly speaks of the Trinity? Of course that matters. And yet we both agree that that was a verse that was added centuries, over a millennium later than the original New Testament was penned. We do have a sense of what those earlier documents say, and we do have a sense of what the original or autographic or initial or Ausgang's text says. These things matter to me, not because I think any essential teaching of Christianity is at stake, but because I am a historian who wants to get back to that wording as early as we possibly can of what Paul actually wrote, what the Gospels actually were about, what the book of Acts really was speaking of, what the rest of the letters in the book of Revelation originally said from the pen of the author as it was dispatched to his readers. This is why I founded the Center for the Study of New Testament Manuscripts, so that we could photograph these manuscripts and analyze them and help the rest of the world of scholars to think through what they're all about. Bart said that historians always base their judgment on probabilities. I would say that's exactly right. We don't do it on the basis of certainties. We don't have those kinds of certainties. But he continues to speak of my view as one of certainty. But that's not true. I have relative certainty about these things, but he seems to be absolutely unsure about them. And yet, at the same time, in his book, Forged, not written 20 years ago, but written this year, he seems to presuppose that he knows what Paul's authentic letters, down to the vocabulary, was about. Now, I'm not judging him for that. I'm simply saying any work that we do outside of textual criticism presupposes, when we're working in the New Testament, it presupposes that we have a pretty darn good idea what the original text actually said. And even in his book, Forged, as well as the rest of his books on the New Testament, he presupposes the same thing, whether he says that or not. I think our task here, and the task for all of you, is to pursue truth at all costs. And I think Bart and I are both sincerely on that pursuit, and I want to thank you for a marvelous, lively, and even very fun evening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dan. Let's give both of them one more round of applause. If we can only speak in terms of probability, I think it's highly probable that most people found this to be an extremely stimulating debate. Thank you to both of you for coming, for being a part of this, for organizing it. Thank you for your attentiveness as an audience. Let me remind you to put your contact information in the baskets as you leave. Let me remind you of the dinner at Abacus next week. I will ask that you clear out of the auditorium as quickly as possible because our time is limited, but that you linger at the book tables. Thank you very much for coming. Have a good night.
I think I would base the strength of winning and losing off of kind of like they did with high probability of manuscripts and low probability of manuscripts. I would base it on weak induction and strong induction in that regard. And I would say that the strongest conclusion that someone came to tonight was Dr. Wallace, and then I would say the person at the strongest induction for those conclusions was Dr. Wallace, for sure.
Well, I think that the entire debate definitely gave some insight into the New Testament and just how much we do know. I mean, how long all of these texts have been around, how many times it's been, you know, recopied. Just, it's amazing to me that we still have so many texts with the original integrity of the manuscripts, and I mean, I really think it's amazing that we do have all the truth that we do from the manuscripts that we still are able to look at today.
I really think Dr. Wallace won the debate just because of the ocean of evidence that he presented for the trustworthiness of the New Testament. I mean, the topic they were debating is, can we trust the text, right? Well, I just think the overwhelming amount of evidence that was presented for the trustworthiness of the New Testament really went to Dr. Wallace, where Dr. Ehrman just over and over kept saying, we can't know, we can't know, we can't know. And he was kind of like that beach ball floating on top of the ocean. You know, as the evidence was being more and more presented, the beach ball just kept getting higher and higher and higher. So I really think Dr. Wallace won, hands down. And, you know, it's really interesting to see two scholars, great scholars, wonderful men, being able to talk about this in a professional way at a scholarly level. I really think it opens people's eyes to the deeper debate that's going on here about the trustworthiness of the text. So I think it was good that way. It's worthwhile to debate because people base their entire lives on the answer to this question. And people have millions of people have died over the centuries because of this document. That alone should tell us it's a very important document. Because we have so much evidence should tell us that it's more important than any document in antiquity, and we should ask the question why. Even if we can't construct it fully in its original autograph, we should still ask the question, why is there this ocean of evidence?
I'm not saying anybody won. To me, Wallace gave somewhat more compelling backup for his position. I think it's the first debate I've ever seen where the person representing the, what you might say the conservative side was a relativist, but the liberal was the absolutist. Not really. I mean, I think what Wallace said was pretty compelling about the relative amount of manuscripts we have for extra-biblical literature in the Greco-Roman world. I'd like to know if Greco-Roman classical scholars have the same standard of proof that Ehrman has for the New Testament manuscripts. Are they going to set that same standard for Homer and Livy and Pliny and these other ancient historians? I suspect they don't, but I just don't know.
Who, if anybody, won this debate?
I think hands down Dan Wallace did.
Why do you say that?
Well, he seemed to address the questions, in my opinion, more fully. And I think the questions that he asked to Dr. Ehrman, he never really fully responded, in my opinion. Well, I really want to go back and look at the argument that Ehrman made about the second and third century copyists, that they weren't professional, that they were illiterate. And to me, it seemed like an argument from silence, which I've always understood as a very poor form of argumentation. But nonetheless, I still want to look into it.